Top ten.
Well, get us started. Welcome to today's Elihu Katz colloquium. It's my great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Caty Borum Chattoo. Caty is an alum of our school, holding a master's degree in communication from the Annenberg School. She received her undergraduate degree in communication studies from Virginia Tech. She's also completed coursework for the FMA in film production from the University of Southern California School of Cinema and Television. Currently, Caty is co-director of the Center for Media and Social Impact, an executive in residence at the American University School of Communication in Washington, D.C. She is an award-winning strategist, producer, and researcher working at the intersection of social change, communications, research, and storytelling production. Caty's social change and storytelling strategy and research work has been featured in the New York Times, USA Today, NPR, Business Week, The Huffington Post, and PBS Media Shift, and her social justice documentaries have aired on the Sundance Channel, Pivot, NDTV in India, TBS World, Link TV, KCET, DirecTV, and more. She has produced two theatrical documentary feature films, Walmart, The High Cost of Low Price, and The After Party, a TV documentary and transmedia series funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation called Stand Up Planet, which I think she'll talk a little bit about today, several half-hour documentary TV specials, a seven-part documentary TV series called Sierra Club Chronicles, and PSA campaigns designed for social change on issues ranging from global poverty to climate change to HIV. She is a lead strategist for the Gates Foundation-funded View Change Project. She produced the View Change Global Poverty TV series and architected and directed social impact campaign partnerships with international humanitarian organizations, include Save the Children, Oxfam America, Bread for the World, and more. As a writer on social impact and storytelling, she's a frequent contributor to the Huffington Post and Documentary Magazine. In 2016, she co-created and launched Story Movements, a new initiative and convening focused on story-led movements for social justice, funded by the MacArthur and Ford Foundations, as well as the Fledgling Fund and Atlantic Philanthropies. Caty was an invited juror for the 2014 and 2015 International BritDoc Documentary Impact Awards, and she's been an invited speaker on the topic of storytelling, media, and social change at international and national convenings, including AFI Docs, the Skoll World Forum, the International Documentary Association, Tribeca Film Festival, Frank Conference for Social Change, as well as academic and professional conferences. Previously, she was Senior Vice President in the Social Marketing Practice Group, Fleshman Hiller International Communications in Washington, D.C., where she served on the Senior Leadership Team for a National White House Teen and Anti Drug Campaign that won the communication industry's highest honor, the Silver Anvil for Public Service. In Los Angeles, she was a longtime collaborator with legendary TV producer and philanthropist activist Norman Lear, as a founding director of Declare Yourself, a national youth civic engagement organization, where she directed public opinion research and digital strategy for an effort that cultivated more than 2 million new young voters in 2004. I should say that even though Caty graduated from Annenberg before I arrived, it was in that project that I first met her before I was here at Annenberg, because I was working at the Pew Charitable Trust, which was involved with some of that work. And I don't know if I'm remembering this correctly, but I like to think this is the truth, that even if it's an alternative fact, that I first met her. We had been collaborating and working on this, but I first actually met her at Norman Lear's house in Los Angeles, which was one of the things I will remember just before I die, because it was one of the highlights of my life being able to be there. What's that?
Just to be clear.
Yes. No, the whole thing. So she also, while at Norman Lear, was senior producer at the USC Norman Lear Center, a research and public policy center that examines the social impact of entertainment on society. She also served as program officer in the Kaiser Family Foundation's Entertainment, Media, and Public Health Program, where she managed research-based HIV awareness partnership programs, TV specials, and PSA campaigns with MTV and BET. And she's project director at the Center for Media Education and a fellow in civic journalism at the Philadelphia Inquirer. Today, Caty, I went to all the trouble of giving you that much detail because Caty, I think, really represents one model of being a scholar practitioner that I think is a really crucial one. She's been involved both in the on-the-ground work of using communication theory and research and practice for important issues of social justice. At the same time she's been doing all that, she's been not only taking theories of communication and applying them, but learning from those experiences to write academic, scholarly, and more popular pieces that talk about what this connection is. And I think it's a great model for us all to be thinking about and for graduate students to be thinking about. So today, Caty will be talking about the role of documentary and entertainment storytelling for social change, intersecting contemporary practice and scholarship. I should mention, as I think most of the grad students and I hope the faculty know, she's also available to meet with interested students and faculty, talk about her ongoing work at American University and opportunities for collaboration that sit at the intersection of theory, research, and practice. So I encourage students who are interested in these topics to take time to talk with Caty or get her email address. So please join me in welcoming Annenberg alum Caty Borum Chattoo.
Thank you. Thanks, Michael. Hi, everyone. Okay, let me just get my bearings. So I did not know you were going to read my whole bio. I'm horrified. Hi, everyone. So actually, Michael saved me the trouble of going through some of the details of my career, but I actually thought it would be useful if I go through a little bit of it with you all because it brings me to the work that I'm really here to talk to you all about. So yes, I am Caty Borum Chattoo, and I was in school here a long time ago in the late 90s. And my whole lens and my entire career comes from what I did here. So I feel like I want to say that first as a big gesture of gratitude, even though I definitely felt some imposter syndrome, which I've learned is common at Penn. So as Michael said, as I kind of describe myself, I produce documentaries that are involved in social justice work, social justice topics. I use a model of entertainment education, which I'm going to talk about, and I use research in all of it, and I use the best of our theories, particularly as we've evolved in entertainment education theories, narrative transportation, the role of emotion, and so forth, to really inform that work. So I'm going to talk to you all about that today. So as Michael mentioned, I arrived here by way of a couple of different cities after I left Penn. I went to Washington, then I was in San Francisco with the Kaiser Family Foundation, then I was in Hollywood with Norman Lear, and I made my way back to Washington to kind of put that all together. And I'm currently in production for a new documentary project called Mixed, which is about the identities and values and issues that face biracial people 50 years after the Levin versus Virginia Supreme Court case. I'm giving a big talk about that next week, so if anybody wants to talk to me about that, I'm happy to talk about how you make a documentary from scratch, and it's a personal narrative doc. My family is biracial, so that has been one of the greatest creative challenges of my career. I have all kinds of empathy for people that I've put on camera all this time. So, why am I here and why are you here? So you're here for the super great food. I thought it was going to be sandwiches, like real food. Specifically, Michael and I thought it would be interesting, as he mentioned in my bio, to talk about this intersection of practice, production, storytelling, and the role that scholarship plays in that work. And it is my opinion that occasionally in the production world, I'll just go ahead and put that right on our shoulders, I don't think that we dive enough into the academic literature to understand the answers that exist there that need to be translated. And from a self-serving perspective, I have a research fellowship that I'm dying to fill, and I actually told Michael that I wanted to come to Penn first to fill it, and I'll talk about that specifically. It's a new project called the Rise Up Media and Social Change Project in partnership with Univision, which, as you may or might not know, owns many English language networks. Fusion, The Root, The Onion. So we're doing a lot of work in comedy and social change. So I hope that you'll hear with an active listening perspective with the idea that perhaps we might collaborate or perhaps we might work together. So I really have worked in my career in three different areas that I've combined together. And I'll tell you quite honestly that one of the reasons why I've combined these three areas is because I'm easily bored. And I don't like to rely too heavily on one area or another. But to me, these are all intersections, these bodies of work that get to both the psychological effects and impact of great storytelling when it comes to social justice, and also gets into some of the sociological impacts. So, but it's important for me to say to you all that as a researcher and a producer, I am entirely motivated by asking and answering questions about what works, what can we learn more about, and how can we put that back into the practice of storytelling that's designed for social change. And for me, there's no question that I ask and operationalize as a research project that is not designed to do that. So it's actually a pretty helpful compass, because I hear a lot of questions in the professional storytelling world. People say, like I was just telling Michael, someone just said the other day at a meeting, but why do people watch documentaries? I was like, ooh, we should do that. We should do that research. And there are three ideas that I want to raise with you all and be a little bit provocative here. I actually think there's a void between what we know in scholarly work and the questions that are informed in professional practice. I think there's a translation problem. I often call myself a hybrid. So I sit in that middle space of professional storytelling production, but also using our research and our theories to pull it all together. Also, with a void comes great opportunities. I think there's incredible opportunity. There's a new ecosystem around nonfiction storytelling and social justice, which I'll tell you about. It's exploding around the world, pretty exciting. So I kind of live professionally in that space. And then most importantly, as you can see here, for those of you all, you all are all experts. You are the best of the best in communication, so you know all this already. But I don't believe when we look at social change that's fostered by storytelling, and particularly in the nonfiction space, I don't think we can answer those questions through story-based effects alone, because there is so much grassroots momentum that happens around stories that are designed with social justice in mind. So I figured to arrive at our eventual destination, which is to look at documentary storytelling and social change, and I have a couple of good case studies, including a comedy documentary about global poverty that I produced that I'll tell you about. But to arrive there, I figured I should just, for you all not to assume that you know the foundation of how I work and how my career evolved in that way. So I'll just take you all through a really quick jaunt through that, and I'm gonna be pretty fast on this first part to make sure that we get to clips, because they're funny. So just to not make any assumptions about where I reside as the foundation of what I think of in terms of social change, I use the work from entertainment education, Singal and Rogers. But how many people are working in entertainment education or have? I got a few emails from a few people. Okay, that must be my new friend Danny. Send me a note. I saw the USC shirt, that's how I knew. So I love the flexibility of this foundation, because a lot of the work that I do, depending on what the social issue is and where the social justice needs to go, there is either infrastructure change or individual change or some or awareness on the way to behavior change. It's not monolithic, right? So this this foundation allows us to examine the level of the individual, community, organization, or society. So in my storytelling and social change work, I start with the Sabido model. Everybody familiar with the Sabido model? I'll tell you the quick story. Anybody not familiar with the Sabido model? Oh, I'll tell the quick story. Okay, I'm gonna tell it quick, even though I like to tell it colorfully, but I won't, because I don't want to use up all my time. So there was, in 1969 and 1970 in Peru, a popular telenovela called Simplemente Maria, here's the cover, focused on the storyline of a young poor maid who was illiterate at the time and sort of destined to a life of servitude and domestic work. And in the telenovela, she teaches herself how to read and write, and she teaches herself how to sew, and she becomes a very successful seamstress. So what happens in Peru at the time is adult literacy rates go up, adult literacy signups for young women went up, and sales of Singer sewing machines also increased. I like the part that is Singer sewing machines specifically. I don't know if there were other brands at the time. So a researcher and producer in Mexico, also of telenovelas, named Miguel Sabido, wanted to understand, can we build a model? Can we actually understand what those forces were? And so he built a model that is informed by social science, social cognitive theory, parasocial relationships, the idea of emotional appeals. And of course, once you get people riled up and they experience a social issue through entertainment, if you don't tell them what to do, they might not do it. So the idea of an epilogue or a call to action, which is what we do a lot in documentaries for social justice. So all of my work comes from this foundation. Sometimes I loosely interpret the entertainment education model, and sometimes, depending on the work, it's strictly enforced. Sometimes I find that when you're doing nonfiction storytelling, if you adhere too strongly to a model of the protagonist needs to do this and the antagonist needs to do this, you squeeze out the possible artistry, which could lead to the effect, so loosely interpreted. But based on that, what I ended up doing with that is I went to the Kaiser Family Foundation, and I'll just give a little more color to this because it is involved in the nonfiction work. So I worked with producers at ER and MTV and BET, and in the late 90s, the work that we were doing mostly was around HIV awareness and HIV testing. It was a very different time around HIV and stigma and lack of understanding and the degree of the public health crisis in this country. And so my job was to work with producers to incorporate pro-social messages into entertainment programming, and of course, to use public health data to inform what those messages should be, very Bob Hornickian, and then to evaluate what happens when people experience those kinds of storylines through entertainment. So that model is very classic entertainment education. And then you can see Norman Lear here. I made my way to Los Angeles because I thought, you know, if I'm going to be working in this entertainment storytelling that involves social good in some way, I should probably go to Hollywood because that's what I should do. So I will not bore you with the details of how I landed with Norman Lear, but he created a job for me, and we started working together, and I was a founding director of this organization called Declare Yourself, which uses storytelling and entertainment around civic engagement for young people, and that is indeed where I met Michael. And I will tell you, there is nothing like learning at the feet of a real master. Norman Lear, for those of you who don't know, created the model for pro-social television in the 70s and 80s with On the Family and The Jeffersons and many, many shows. The thing that people don't know, if you don't know him necessarily, is that his contemporary imprint is found on most television shows today that actually use that model. All of the showrunners, the executive producers who run those shows, are his friends, and they love him, and he teaches them how to do what he does. And as a quick commercial for Norman, in case he ever watches this, because he'd be mad if I mentioned him and didn't say that he has a new Netflix show on, he has a remake of One Day at a Time. Have you all read about this? Yes. It's probably going to win awards. He re-envisioned it as a Cuban-American family, so pretty interesting. So in the course of that, we also worked on comedy for social change projects, which would not surprise you, because Norman is a great comic writer and producer, so that's what we were up to. But the point of telling you all that story is less about a biography and more about saying that I felt like it was really important if I was going to continue in a career of examining storytelling effects or how social justice work happens around stories, that I should learn how storytelling production and decisions and creative decision-making happens. And so that's what I got working for Norman more than anything, and also a lot of freedom because he's an entrepreneur. So then I went to work in Washington, and these are just a few of the campaigns in a social marketing context. I'm sure a lot of you are doing public health work and social marketing because Bob Hornick is here. But these were a couple of the projects that I worked on that were, of course, using the great traditions of social marketing, lots of audience research and targeting, lots of creative work. But to be honest with you all, I felt like the creativity was a little bit strangled in that kind of work, at least the work that I was doing at the agency level, at a big communication agency, because I won't go into too much depth about that. So through those traditions, I thought, just backing up a little bit, so I was doing the work with Norman and doing the storytelling work, and then I thought, well, I'm in LA, so I should do what one does in LA, which is go to film school, and I had one more year before my GRE scores ran out, and I knew there was no way I was taking it again. So I quickly got into film school at USC. But the real reason that I did that is that along the way, I had been really inspired by a couple of different pieces of work. One was a book by Studs Terkel called Working, which is really a documentary book about the intimate portraits of people working in largely invisible positions in the United States, 1974 book. And I had seen Roger and Me, which was Michael Moore's first movie before he became kind of known as a progressive lightning rod. He was just this funny producer. Have you all seen Roger and Me? It's so great. But I knew when I watched Roger and Me, I thought, I have never thought about Flint, Michigan in my whole life. But I will never not think about Flint, Michigan after I watch this movie. So I knew something happened to, for me. And for me, just in terms of my creative self, I thought, oh, that is the art form that I want to work in, to combine this research-based approach. I really want to work in the intimacy of nonfiction storytelling. So I did that. So I went to the MFA program, and ironically, I did not finish it because I was hired to actually make movies instead of my thesis film. I don't know if that was a great decision, but let's see, what did I want to tell you all about this? Yeah, so as I continued to work in this model, I decided to try to combine an EE kind of model to documentary storytelling around social justice topics. And I think of the power of documentary storytelling in a couple of different ways, but I figured I would show you all a couple of quotes to kind of bifurcate the two different ways that I think about it. And then I'll get into some examples. So the form is important to understand when we think about documentary storytelling. And mostly the work that I'm in, as you all already know, because I've said it 18,000 times, is really social issue documentaries, looking at contemporary social justice issues that either are, there is a lens missing perhaps in mainstream media coverage, or it simply is a voice that is not heard, or an issue that we just don't know about. I'm really moved by that kind of storytelling. And the sort of godfather of documentary, a guy named Paul Rotha in 1935, above all, documentary must reflect the problems and realities of the present. So that remains true, even though documentary takes on increasingly creative forms. There are historical reenactments. There's lots of artistic work that happens in documentary now that I think wasn't happening in the kind of straight newsreel type of docs of Paul Rotha's era. But then artistic choices matter as much as journalistic ones. And that's another important piece, particularly later on when we talk about studying the effects of documentary film. I think it's incredibly important to not necessarily make documentary synonymous with investigative journalism. There are some noted departures. There are some ethical questions that are different for documentary storytelling. And then, of course, in the kind of work that I do, this notion of grassroots publics that may take action and even form either overt social action campaigns around social issues, that's what I'll talk a little bit about today, or the sort of activism happens organically, as in the case of the Blackfish film, which I'll talk about a little bit. And this comes from a piece that I'll talk about in a few minutes. So let me tell you all, I like to tell stories when I give talks, because I know that everybody, this is very meta, everybody pays attention to stories. So the first project that I worked on in this space, and it was one of the first to use this kind of model of social justice storytelling that combines overtly with a grassroots action campaign around it, and that was Walmart, The High Cost of Low Price. I think it's on Netflix. I haven't checked in a while. It was on Netflix for a while. I don't know if it's still there. In about 2004, 2005, I don't know how many of you all remember this, but the negative press around Walmart was pretty acute. So there were leaks coming out from managers who were inside. And of course, I will not assume that everybody knows this, but Walmart is the number one company in the world. So it's important to examine not just for the sake of looking at Walmart, but because it's a race to the bottom. So how Walmart behaves and encourages its suppliers and others to behave influences a lot of local economies, et cetera. So at the time, there was a lot of negative press. And so I teamed up with a guy named Robert Greenwald, who is a kind of muckraking documentarian who makes a lot of sort of loud progressive movies. He was a little bit more under the radar at the time that we made this movie. But basically, the story is there were about four of us who ran around the country for about a year. I have great war stories for another day, with very small crews going into small communities and telling the stories of things like what happens when Walmart opens in town and every other business shuts down, subsidies given from the government that were kind of under the radar, many stories about systemic discrimination of women and people of color, environmental abuses that were pretty extreme at the time. It was one of the worst EPA violators at this time. And they would just pay the fines and keep moving. So as I always say to my own students, it was not a pro-Walmart movie. I'm sure you can tell. But what we did around the grassroots organizing was interesting and is definitely influences my work today and influenced a lot of the grassroots mobility building around documentaries that work in this way 12 years later. So we had a grant. I will not walk you through all the details of this, but I'm so happy to talk about this when I meet with students later or follow up. But it would take me 2 hours to talk about everything that we did. But we definitely had a ground game, grassroots advocacy work. Walmart Week was a classic political organizing kind of project where we involved interest groups around the country who were each concerned about Walmart for different reasons. We actually cut special edits of the film, particularly for certain verticals. So we had the environmental vertical, and we had Sierra Club and NRDC and lots of organizations. We had a human rights vertical that had to do with human rights abuses of undocumented workers and others. We had a discrimination vertical. We had we had, I think, maybe 5 different verticals that we cut into 20-minute versions of the film so that people could use them as the centerpiece of their advocacy and their own grassroots work on the ground fighting back against Walmart. And the other piece that's important to note here is that, and I'll expand on this a little bit later, but documentaries are experienced in such different ways than we experience other kinds of entertainment programming. And I have to think, and I haven't expanded this research yet, but it's on my list, that examining how we experience documentaries has to be part of the effects conversation because it can be very intimate. I still meet people today who say, I saw your movie in my church basement, and my pastor invited us to go. Now, that's very different than stumbling across a movie that you're going to see on the Discovery Channel or something. Although this had a classic entertainment rollout. It was in theaters, it was in a festival, it was on TV, now it's on Netflix, so it was classic in that way, but very intimate in the grassroots structure. A fun fact that, of course, I cannot validate with science, but I don't know if anybody remembers that there used to be a different logo for Walmart, and it looked kind of like that, but it wasn't a mean face. So a year later, all of a sudden, there was a very generic Starburst logo, which is kind of a hilarious effect that we take credit for. But that was Evil Smiley, the logo. Not scientific at all. Part of what happened in the evolution after the film, there's lots of, at some point, there's a book about this. I should have mentioned that. There's a book about the making of the movie and what happened. It's somewhat horrifying because it has some of the war stories in it. But Walmart expanded its health care for workers. That was one of the major through lines of the film. There was a huge environmental justice story, as mentioned, and a couple years after that, Walmart greened its distribution system. So I still don't shop at Walmart, but I would say it's probably a pretty different company. Not scientific. So getting back to the big picture, so that was kind of the start for me in a way. And at the same time, the digital era was evolving, as we all know, and the conditions under which people can make documentaries was changing pretty dramatically. So it was a whole cadre of people who are waiting in the wings to take on social justice problems in this way and to use documentary combined with grassroots activism. So as I see it, can we explain anecdotally why there's a kind of rise in an ecosystem of this kind of work, which I'll talk about. I think these are pretty obvious, but yeah, a rise in accessible technology for makers. So all of a sudden, film gear was really accessible. So when I was in the film program at USC, it was in this century, by the way, but it was tape. And USC has this very romantic thing where they you still have to cut film because they think Steven Spielberg learned cutting film. So you have to like cut the film. Anybody a film person here? Do you know how to edit film? You know, when you physically cut film and you splice it and you send, anyway. So yes, I feel like I have total street cred for that. But now, obviously, in the digital era, we don't have to know how to physically splice film and we don't need to know how to roll a film camera. It's much more accessible. Audience discovery shifts in the digital area. This one is super obvious, but with the rise of Netflix and Amazon and iTunes, all of a sudden, audience can find documentaries. And that becomes really important, not just for the process of discovery, but the idea of which audiences actually seek out docs. So I hear from my own students, I teach social change communication. I teach a lot about storytelling, as you might imagine. And this is how they are all discovering it. So you all are like my students. An investigative role and a whole, perhaps. Now, this is a theory. It is not yet tested, but I was telling Michael, I have a whole list of research questions that I will systematically operationalize into research because I must know the answers to them. But I find myself anecdotally when I speak at film festivals and things like that, I inadvertently hear myself say something like, and documentaries are increasingly filling the hole that has been vacated by investigative journalism. And then I thought, is that true? Maybe we should research that so that we have a but now operationalizing that is pretty tricky, right? There are a number of documentary organizations and individuals who have popped up to kind of fill this space between investigative documentary and investigative journalism and documentary, so much so that one of the things that we're doing at the Center for Media and Social Impact is designing journalistic training for documentarians who work in this way because they don't have the same journalistic protections, they don't have access to insurance in the same way, so there's a wide range of considerations. And then, of course, grassroots engagement, both purposeful and organic, that is really born of digital era organizing. I know there is a big focus on that in this school, so I'll just let that rest here since you all know exactly what I'm saying and more. So let me give you a few examples before I go any further, just to bring this to life a little bit. So these are ad hoc, anecdotal sort of effects things. They are not scientific effects learnings that I'm going to talk about, but I just want to give you a sense of when I keep using this idea of this term of ecosystem around documentaries and social change, I want you to know that I'm not making it up. So let me give you a few ideas. So the film Food Inc., which was produced by a company called Participant Media, which brought us An Inconvenient Truth and The Cove and a number of other projects. We actually had a partnership program with them for a couple of years where we would do the formative research to help design the social impact work around those films and television shows. But anyway, in the case of Food Inc., there was a USC study that found that people had changed their food shopping and eating behaviors more than a year after watching the film. The film Invisible War, how many of you all have heard of this one? Well, it's fun to talk about things nobody knows. So the Invisible War, I'll just tell you really briefly. It's an investigation into sexual assault in the military, which prior to this film, and you can answer this question by just looking at simple media coverage, this was not something that was known to the civilian population in the United States. It turns out this is quite a huge problem numerically and from a chain of command problem in the military. So the Invisible War actually led to and is cited in 20 pieces of proposed legislation that are hanging out. So the final infrastructure and policy change is yet to be seen. But the point is, it took a nascent social issue from a civilian population and put it on the media agenda and the public agenda in a way that was not known before. A film called Semper Fi. These are all great, by the way. These are all Academy Award nominated films. Not every documentary works in that way, by the way, but it just so happens that a couple of the ones I'm talking about are. Semper Fi was a film that looked at widespread contamination at Fort Camp Lejeune in North Carolina. It turns out that Marines and their families have been systematically poisoned over the years through toxic water contamination. And this Marine whose daughter died when she was 10, he started an investigation of his own and basically went up against the Department of Defense and the Marine Corps, and it's this incredible documentary story. But the point of telling you all this is we have a report series coming out in the next 2 months about the role of documentary films in public policy on the federal, state, and local levels. And this is one of the projects that we highlight because this led to a new piece of federal legislation that we write about with quite a bit of depth. But the piece of this that's interesting, just to lodge in your brains a little bit, was This was a classic environmental justice story, but the framing is around patriotism and Marine Corps, and so it was able to have a bipartisan effect, which is pretty hard to do for some documentaries attempting to have policy, attempting to lead to policy change. So it was an important project. And finally, the Project Bully. How many of you all have seen this one? Yeah, a couple of you. So this is a project that, the important thing that I wanted to mention about this film, it was, I think, 2013, so a couple of years ago, but Bully introduced bullying legislation in the school system in a way that had been kind of, bullying was sort of seen as a kind of rite of passage, officially speaking, like, oh, we've all been through it, we'll get over it. But this was a film that really, right after a rash of suicides from young people in 2010, do you all remember the It Gets Better campaign? So this was right during that time, GLBT young people in particular. But this had all kinds of implications at the federal agency level, which we talk about in this public policy series. So anyway, the point of this is to say these films are doing something. They're doing something in a unique way. Yes, they use a lot of the concepts that we certainly all understand, framing, agenda setting, all of that. But they're working in a different kind of way, I think. I thought that was my phone. I almost had a heart attack. So there are four focus areas that I believe are where the kind of meat of this work is in terms of examining the effects, examining the way the documentaries work, and cycling that back into the production of the work so that it can be more effective when we think about social justice topics. So these are my four focus areas as somebody who produces them and thinks about them and now does research on them. So the marketplace distribution model, as I've already mentioned, is pretty unique to documentaries. So how audiences experience social issue documentaries is very different from scripted Hollywood films. That's not a mystery to anyone. But each place in the marketplace on a documentary film's life cycle actually brings new audiences, but new opportunities for grassroots engagement. So a classic film like the ones that I just showed you, a sort of classic documentary film, will have a festival premiere, then it will get theatrical, it will be released into theaters, then it will probably get a TV deal, which comes with its own kind of marketing machinery. And then it usually goes on a grassroots circuit, so an educational circuit to churches, synagogues, all kinds of places. And then we'll have, now today, we'll have a streaming premiere. So each one of those demographically is quite different, and the way that the grassroots engagement happens around each one of those touchstones is different. So I feel like this is something that needs to be researched really of its own, in its own way, not just from the storytelling effects model. But then, of course, the story effects are very exciting to look at. I love the entertainment education literature, as mentioned. It is the foundation of my work. I love how the theoretical work has really expanded in this area over the last 16 years or so, beginning with the narrative transportation model in 2000 and the role of emotion, and so much more that we know now than we did when I was doing this work in the late 90s. But let me tell you what we know so far about documentaries and the intersection with media effects work. So, and it is possible that I don't know everything, so I'll just put that out there. So those of you who know the original narrative transportation model from Green and Brock know that actually there were no differences in storytelling effects depending on whether something was a nonfiction story or a scripted story. And I always go back to that to say, because a lot of the work in the narrative transportation space is looking at scripted work, and I kind of want us to not forget about documentary storytelling. I feel like it works differently. So what we know so far, there were a couple of studies, one on the Rwandan genocide that looked at the differences between people experiencing a documentary about the Rwandan genocide versus the scripted film, Hotel Rwanda. And here I'm quoting to make sure I do not mess up their conclusions. But increased levels of issue learning and concern, along with greater feelings of guilt and disgust. Narrative engagement was attributed to telling a real story. So there's a little bit of evidence there that we're onto something. You have a colleague here, Emil. Is he here? I meant to tell him I was coming because we've emailed a bunch. Anyway, do you all know Emil's new work on Boudros, the documentary? Okay, I'll let him talk to you about it, but increased empathy for underdogs with some fancy neuroscience. And another film that looked at environmental justice films and found increased levels of donation after watching. But there is really nothing that connects the entertainment education literature and role of emotion, character involvement, entertainment value, all of that that lives in the kind of scripted entertainment education effects. It hasn't yet been applied to documentary work. So I am kind of excited about that because I want to do that work. And actually, I have one study that will be published later this year that I'll talk to you all about a little bit that attempts to expand that literature. So grassroots engagement and amplification. Let me tell you all something that I hope you don't know, because I think this is actually pretty amazing as a development. There is a new class of producer that works in documentary called the impact producer. Now, those of us who have worked in advocacy or social change communication kind of know this model because it is social change communication and advocacy. But an impact producer job on a social issue documentary is to deeply understand where might the social issue lead to change? Where is there possibility for infrastructure versus individual change, awareness versus policy, state level, federal? So it's that person's job to understand the creativity and the decision-making of the story, but also to put in place the social impact strategy that goes around the film. This is such an important ecosystem now in this space that there is a project called Good Pitch that is run by a group called BritDoc that I do a lot of collaborative work with. They have created this model that actually works in 20 countries around the world where they combine social issue NGOs, civil society, and documentary filmmakers who have produced a story around their area, and they build a model for them to work together to impact social change. So it's pretty exciting, and I work in that space, but now I'm going to write about it so that I'm not, so it's not just those of us who work in it who know about it. So that is a lot, that has a lot to do with the really purposeful work of social change around this space, or the advocacy work. And then finally, documentary, as with other forms of storytelling, has a diversity problem. So we've actually just released what I affectionately call Oscars So White for Documentaries 2 study. We just released it. It's a content analysis. We looked at 10 years of Oscar shortlisted documentary films to look at race and gender of producers and directors. And we sort of knew this anecdotally already, those of us who work in the space. But this is important, obviously, because whose stories are told and whose stories are not told and from what lens obviously matters when we're thinking about the intersection of social issues and storytelling. So I feel like that's pretty obvious. Okay. I think we should all stay here till 3 o'clock because I'm going to show you clips. Okay, so let me bring some of these ideas to life in A Tale of Two Documentaries. Okay, I'm going to try to tell this one quickly, but it's one of my favorite projects of all time. So as Michael mentioned, I have produced a TV series called View Change. And View Change was designed to raise awareness of progress that we were being made, that we were making as a globe toward solving extreme poverty, so global development issues. And so what happened with View Change, this terribly earnest TV series, it was a series of half-hour specials that were looking at things like progress toward maternal health, infant mortality, malnutrition, HIV, sanitation. And I will not reveal names necessarily, but we had a pretty senior level person/funder in our team who said, yes, the production value is great, but we are so bored. So the challenge was to myself and a group of producers, about five of us, can you experiment with a new way to tell a story about global development? We really worry that when we think about global poverty issues, we are only preaching to the choir, and we're only going to reach people that are already thinking about it. We're not going to reach people who are either apathetic or perhaps young people that are not thinking about this already. And who is going to seek out an earnest half hour about infant mortality on a Friday night, right? That is like a worthy criticism. So what we decided to do was comedy. And so I don't know how many of y'all recognize this guy, but this is Hasan Minhaj. He is now a correspondent on The Daily Show. He was not a correspondent on The Daily Show when we cast him, which is good because he would not have had time to do our movie. But Stand Up Planet was born. So Stand Up Planet is a documentary two-part series that aired internationally and here in the United States. It was a festival film and also on five different television networks. But basically, here's the sort of creative log line, and then I'll tell you the geekier stuff about behind the scenes. So the long line is, Hasan Minhaj, stand-up comic, goes in search of the funniest stand-up comics in the developing world, and he follows their jokes deep into the social issues of their day. And by the way, their social issues are what we call global development, right? So here's where I'm going to hopefully get to a clip. But let me tell you about the story development really quickly, because this brings together all of the work that I've talked about thus far. So we used an entertainment education model for this, not strictly enforced, because we felt very strongly that if we squeeze the, and by the way, entertainment education does not squeeze the life out of entertainment. I want to make sure I'm not on the record saying that. But we felt really strongly that there needed to be very strong creative liberties on this project, because we were working with comics and stand-up comics. And the minute you try to censor that, it's not funny. And if you're trying to use the comedy be persuasive, as you all know, it's not persuasive if it's not very funny, right? Like, not professionally funny. So the other work, we've worked very deeply with researchers in global development at UNICEF and other places to really understand, if we tackle global development, are there particular areas that that seem to be winnable when we think about global development issues? And so we called these actionable opportunities, and so we specifically looked at sanitation-related illnesses in India. There are 1,600 children who die daily because of lack of access to clean water, sanitation-related ripple effect, and HIV in South Africa. South Africa continues to have the highest level rate of HIV infection, although that's improving quite a bit. And then here's one of my favorite parts, because Robin Nabi was a student here when I was here. I haven't even told her that her study helped inform this story. I guess I should do that at some point. But Robin, in a study in which she examines the possibly persuasive impact of comedy, has a piece at the end of this study. She looked at a piece from Chris Rock and manipulated. Anyway, do you all know this study, 2007? Yes, Joe Capella knows this study. So she posits at the end that when we think about comedy and we're worried about message discounting or issue trivialization that may come with comedy, that perhaps a way to deal with that is this idea of a restoration of gravity, that you let the comedy be funny about the issue, but then you tell people what the real issue is so that you can restore the gravity of the situation. So this is the narrative model of Stand Up Planet. So this is how it works in the actual storyline. So they're telling all these jokes, or it's stand-up shows around the world, and then we follow their jokes into the issue. So, you know, cut to Hasan and the comics visiting a sanitation plant in a slum of Mumbai, for example. So it's very earnest and sweet, but it's also kind of funny and sometimes raunchy. But the point is that the characters on the ground in these countries, we wanted them to be real, living, breathing people, not people who were voiceless, not speaking for themselves. So it's a different kind of story. And as I mentioned, the comedy, not strangled. Entertainment value had to be key. So let me play, if I have time. There is a great NPR piece that kind of summarizes it, but we all have to look at a screen while we listen. Is that going to be weird? Can we do that? OK, this is where I look for.
That's my cue.
Yes. I think we could do the NPR piece first. And then I might not have time to play you all 2 minutes. So this is an interview with Hasan Minhaj and Arun Roth of All Things Considered. And it's a 6-minute piece, which is pretty long. But we were pretty happy for the movie to have a 6-minute piece. But it explains how the comedy and the serious social issues work together. So it actually does a better job than our trailer ever did. So thanks, NPR.
Which of the two?
It's the NPR, the bottom one. I might not let you all listen to all 6 minutes.
From Queen Victoria's diaries to tell the story of her rise to power.
That's an ad.
It's been said that comedy is tragedy plus time. It seems that's true across the world.
As a black guy, we do kind of blame apartheid a lot. You know, you have a guy with a headache, you'd be like, hey, what's wrong? I think it's apartheid.
That's Kagiso Ladiga performing in South Africa. He's one of several comedians featured in the documentary Stand Up Planet. L.A.-based comic Hasan Minhaj is our on-screen guide to the stand-up planet. He takes us around the world to find comedians confronting very serious issues with comedy.
There's all sorts of terrible things that happen around the world, and comedy is one of those few things where you can discuss those things.
As Minhaj told me, the goal of this project was to follow the jokes into people's lives.
To show that a comedian on stage in India talking about sanitation, or in South Africa talking about HIV and AIDS awareness, if you follow the joke into their lives, you can see that, like, oh, these things aren't just contrived in joke books. This is real life. I think the best comedians have that bravery and courage to say, oh, this is what it is. This is unfair. That's not cool. And everybody in that moment, collectively, the crowd is like, yes.
Let's start off with the first stop on your trip, which is India. And I think a lot of people have this idea of India, it's a big democracy, so there must be free speech.
Right.
Not so much.
Not so much. I met two amazing comedians, one named Tanmay Bhatt and the other was Aditi Mittal. And Tanmay has one of the most popular podcasts in India.
So what are we discussing on today's episode? Tarun Tejpal, he's in custody right now for 14 days.
It's not even like it was like very lewd or crass. It was controversial in the sense of the institutions that it was mocking and the institutions that it was criticizing that it got pulled off of iTunes India. That didn't stop them. They uploaded it to SoundCloud and to other third-party upload sites where people could still get that content. And that was really cool to see that.
Now, you were, I thought this was pretty brave of you. You decided to perform there.
Yeah.
We have a little clip of your performance.
I got off the plane. They said, hey, there's a guy, his name is Raj, he'll pick you up. I'm in India, man. How many Rajas are there? I come out, there's 97 brown dudes. Sir, sir, sir. Don't. I can't. I'm going to believe all of you.
True story.
Yeah, but they seem to go for it.
Yeah, man. Dude, when I took the stage, man, I'm not going to lie, like, I was just shaking. You know, growing up in the States, there's this part of me that's like, man, I'm Indian. Like, this is where I belong. And as soon as I got to India and I had to go to the bathroom in some places, I was like, man, I am American.
Boy, do I know what you're talking about.
Bring me to Jamba Juice. I love air conditioning and Starbucks. And I would check myself. I was like, Hasan, you are going to the bathroom in this hole. You are doing it. Man up.
So you decided to, you're going to bring a comic from each of the countries you visit. With India, you went with Aditi Mittal.
Aditi Mittal.
Tell us about her.
Aditi is a comedy superstar over in India. She's only one of three female English-speaking comedians in India.
You know, the vaginal beautification industry. They want our vaginas to be fairer. They want our vaginas to be tighter. I'm like, how about we do that for our women's laws?
Aditi might get mad if she hears this. She doesn't like it when I call her a female comedian. She's like, you're a dude comedian. They don't call you penile comedian. Like, don't call me that. And the work that she's doing is transcending gender and race, and it's making people think about gender roles in India and stuff like that.
And the comedian that you brought from South Africa,
Umpho Pops.
He grew up in Soweto.
Africa as a whole, we have a big HIV/AIDS problem, right? And I believe that one of the roots of this problem is that we're not honest with each other. Like, if a woman could come up to you in the beginning of a date and say, yo, hope you got those condoms, right? If you could be honest in the beginning, we'd be better prepared.
HIV and AIDS in South Africa is one of those issues where everybody has a loved one or someone that they know that's had to hide it. And he's talking about something really, really painful, but he's making it so funny.
So you bring these two comedians, you bring Aditi and Umpho here to Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And they get to perform at the Laugh Factory.
Yeah.
How'd they do?
You know what, man? They did great. Everybody at the show, they loved them.
As an Indian traveling abroad, sometimes, actually most of the time, you'll meet this one person who's like, so tell me, like, for real, when did you learn how to speak English? So now I could tell her that, you know, India has been under colonial rule for the past 200 years, and that's why our entire private education system is based in English. But I'm like, you know, on the flight.
They're funny.
They're funny. They're definitely comics. Funny. Yeah, oh, they're really funny.
Like, I thought skating on thin ice was a compliment. For years. My mom would be like, so how's school going? And, hey, mama, they say I'm ice skating.
Listen, you're a comedian, so you're as skeptical and ironic and all those things as you can get.
Sure.
Were you surprised by how this film, by the end, it's pretty earnest? I mean, there's kind of an unironic, earnest sweetness about the power of comedy by the end of this.
Yeah. One of the biggest difficulties that I think the way comedy is represented on screen is it's either just all fart jokes, you know, and it's just laughter for the sake of laughter, or it's one of those things where it's just kind of very preachy, very heavy-handed. I think this project is one of the few things that I've done in my career where it bridges that gap, and we dance in both circles.
Issam Minhaj, great pleasure speaking with you. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you for having me, man.
Stand Up Planet premieres this Wednesday nationally on Pivot and Link TV, and in Southern California on KCET.
Well, I was going to play the first 2 minutes for you, which are very exposition heavy, so you know where the story is going, but I see that I have 5 minutes, so I want to tell you all what happened in the study of this. So there was something I was going to say about Hassan.
Do you want your PowerPoint?
Yes, please. Yes, okay. Thank you. Phil, everyone. So all, you know, I feel like that was probably pretty obvious, but all of those clips come from the movie. So finding the intersection of global development issues with actually what comics were talking about in India and South Africa, which is by far one of the hardest creative projects that I've worked on together, because we had to cast the movie from across the world. So it was many, many hours of Skype at 3 a.m. with India and South Africa. But it actually worked out miraculously. Thank you. And so, yes, we bring the comics back to Hollywood, and they perform in this international comedy showcase. So keeping in mind that we wanted to know, all of this was kind of, I mean, it was a legitimate entertainment project, a documentary that uses, it's sort of a travelogue, as you can imagine, right? So it's his journey, and we follow it. But also, we're intersecting comedy. We have all this global development in it. We have this restoration of gravity idea. And so we wanted to know, did we actually do something interesting? And can it be a contribution back to the scholarly literature, given the gaps in documentary as it connects with entertainment education, entertainment effects, and also about the role of comedy in social change, which is, you all are certainly probably all studying this topic, so I will not attempt to summarize the literature, but it's a little inconclusive in terms of whether or not comedy really trivializes issues, it reduces the severity of them. So we really wanted to know, is there something unique about putting comedy into documentary? So I'm sure a number of you know Lauren Feldman, who finished here in 2008, I think, with her PhD. Yeah, so Lauren and I are working on a series of studies that relate to this work, and this is one that is in final review at the moment, so I hope it will come out this year and I can share it with you all, but we're in the middle of making all kinds of revisions. But here's what we did. So I was funded separately to do a study that looked at two different documentaries together. So we, I was meeting with Michael before this, and I said I actually feel pretty strongly that when we look at effects of documentary storytelling, we can't only look at lab-created storylines. I know that comes with all kinds of limitations from an experimental design perspective that, thank goodness, we will not have time to get into. But we felt it was important to look at two projects that actually existed in the entertainment marketplace, to, you know, because there's artistry and music choice and all of that that would be distorted in a lab-created scenario. So we looked at Stand Up Planet, which is now you all are experts in, and we looked at another documentary project also on global development topics, very similar topics, not precisely the same, but a very different documentary format. So it was what you would think of as kind of a traditional, somber, sort of long-form journalistic piece about global poverty. It was, in fact, similar to the kind of work that we wanted to see if we could experiment with a different way, because we wanted to know, again, if we're preaching to the choir and people aren't going to stumble across it, so what are we really doing with it if people aren't going to go out of their way to watch it? So what we found, a couple of different things, and I'm just going to briefly go through this in my remaining 50 seconds. Do we have a little grace period? Okay.
Some people may have to leave at one.
Okay. I am famous for going over time, by the way. This, like, happens to me weekly. So we wanted to know, does watching, when we're thinking about global development, we had a couple of different things that we were interested in. We wanted to know about increased awareness of global development issues, increased understanding and concern for global development, and increased belief that you know, this has a lot of different sort of philosophical differences depending on how you land on this issue, but we wanted to know if people believed in foreign aid in helping with global development issues, and what kind of action you might be likely to take after you experience these films. So what we found, and it's a you know, pretty complicated study, but I'll just really sort of gloss over it. It does bring documentary into the EE literature, which is the main thing that we wanted to do with this project. So it allows that different genres of documentary may work differently, right? So a comedy travelogue is pretty different from something that is kind of a traditional, serious, some expert talking heads kind of video. We had no expert talking heads in Stand Up Planet, by the way. The people themselves were the experts in their own lives. So we found, interestingly, that both films had increased awareness of global poverty, support for government aid, objective knowledge. We had objective knowledge questions answered pre and post, obviously, and intended actions. Stand Up Planet produced significantly larger gains in awareness, knowledge, and actions, and these effects were mediated by the relatability of the story. So we really wanted to get relatability of the story, so connection with the characters and seeing oneself in the story, positive emotions, and entertainment value. And we felt like that was really important because there's still a bit of an outstanding question about whether comedy that's entertaining is going to sort of take you off the path of the issue. But the end game effects, keeping in mind it was a more traditional doc, were mediated by narrative transportation. Narrative transportation definitely at work in this project. But those effects were mediated by negative emotions. So we found actually that positive emotions and negative emotions for both of these were positively implicated in whether or not people learned more, raised their awareness, and took action. So that was interesting. We don't quite know, and I really am not going to spend much more time on this because I want to talk about one more thing, but we don't totally know yet why the comedy genre, narrative transportation, was not fully at work in this project. We wonder if it has to do with the cognitive processing of the comedy. And there's Dana Young, who's also a graduate, has done a ton of work in that area. Are you all working on comedy and persuasion?
There's a lot of, we've got quite a mixed group here.
Yes. So
there are some people working on persuasion. There's some that's working on entertainment.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Well, it's good that you're not, you all don't completely know everything, because then I would be very intimidated. But anyway, the point is, the objective was to determine whether a comedy-oriented documentary could increase public engagement with this topic and how it might work differently than a serious documentary. And this is obviously not designed to answer everything, because we've just started on this kind of examination. And again, I felt pretty strongly that we wanted to examine films that existed in the marketplace to, with all the limitations that that brings. Again, not unaware of those. But we felt like that was important. And that comes, honestly, from my point of view as a producer, because I know the creative decisions that are made in every piece of a documentary, and it is not journalism. So that has to matter, and we have to examine the effects based on that. So one other thing, just to bring it back to the kind of work that we're continuing to do at the Center for Media and Social Impact. So I think I lured you all here with the description that has to do with the Blackfish effect. Mm-hmm. It's a little bit of a bait and switch. I'm not going to tell you the whole story. But how many of you all have seen the movie Blackfish? Okay. How many of you all have not seen it but know everything that happened? Yeah, I mean, that's really the story of this movie. It's amazing. I mean, not many people have actually seen it. It's kind of hard to watch. So the film Blackfish, and this is something that I've started to write about and kind of build a model around documentary and social change based on what we observed in this project. It needs some more serious research behind it, which we're starting to do this summer. But really quickly, for anybody who doesn't know the story of Blackfish, this is a film. It was a relatively small budget film, but it premiered at the Sundance Film Festival in January 2013, so pretty legitimate in the entertainment marketplace kind of way. And it examined Tilikum, a captive orca held at SeaWorld, and it turns out that, as we learn in the movie, we believe that he sort of became psychotic, because it was like, what the line in the film is, you can't keep someone in a giant bathtub for 30 years and not expect they're not going to, you know, have a psychotic break. And so there's a trainer who was killed. Anyway, so the film is completely the story of Tilikum, the orca. And it sort of personifies him a little bit as a human. You experience his pain. He's a named character. By the way, all of this goes into how we're looking at this issue, because he was a specific character. So 3 years later, after 40 years of a pretty robust business model that was based on orca shows, SeaWorld announced that it was ending its orca shows. So it was 3 years after this small independent documentary. Now, of course, you all know, because you're communication researchers, there's a lot of research that we have to do to start to unpackage why that happened and how we might attribute part of the role of blackfish. There's a content analysis that I'm working on that combines the declining stock price. Thank goodness that stuff is publicly available. Declining stock price against the media coverage and framing over the course of 3 years. That's one way to look at it. But just to show you all, this is a graph that happily the Washington Post prepared when it continued to run stories about this blackfish effect that continued to ripple out. You can actually plot, which I've started to do for this research that we'll wrap up this summer, you can plot the declining stock price against particular moments that happen along the distribution timeline of the film. So again, we're talking about that strategic distribution layered model that I mentioned. So the film goes from Sundance to theaters to CNN, which, despite what the current presidential administration would have us think, I think is ideologically, from an entertainment audience perspective, pretty even-handed. And that matters for a film like Blackfish, which could have easily been sort of dismissed as crazy animal welfare activism, but it's sort of permeated, managed to penetrate through the larger public sphere. So toward a model of documentary for social change, so bringing this all together, the kind of work that we're doing a lot of and that I am personally obsessed with, because I think there are so many things worth studying here. And to me, again, we can't understand the role of documentaries in social justice by looking at storytelling effects alone. We do need to look at storytelling effects. There's no question. It's not well developed, as mentioned. But we can't ignore, in the case of Blackfish, I have a publicly available piece that I wrote about this, but building it out as a scholarly piece. But the role of amplified community and grassroots activism is just enormous in this case. There are animal welfare groups that suddenly became kind of mainstream in the course of this, the activism around the film. The layered marketplace distribution, again, different audiences experiencing these films in different ways in the course of a year. And the media generated and coverage and framing that happened at each moment was actually quite different based on the distribution at the time. So the kind of media coverage you get for a theatrical premiere is very different than the kind that you get from grassroots premieres, very different from streaming premieres, very different audience. So all of that, I believe, had an impact. Narrative effects, as mentioned. So interesting to note that so many people contributed to the Blackfish effect without even watching the movie. I think that is absolutely fascinating. I would routinely take polls in my own classes and say, how many, just like I did with you all, how many of you have not seen Blackfish but are not going to SeaWorld? It's all kinds of people. So that is something worth examining. And then going back to our friend Miguel Cibito and the entertainment education model, the social action and the idea of where the social action should be is actually embedded in the story. So they don't come out, the filmmakers don't say at the end, and therefore you should boycott SeaWorld. But SeaWorld price, you know, stock price went down, declining revenue, sponsors pulled out, the House of Representatives said it was looking into new legislation. It was just a calamity for about 2 years, nonstop, and they could not get away from the media coverage. But the social action is really implied in the story, and I think for those of you all who've seen the movie, know that it's pretty clear that the villain in the story is SeaWorld, so not going is a pretty good way to support the project. So just to wrap up a little bit, although each one of these is a big piece of exposition, these are the kinds of thematic areas that we are working on at the Center for Media and Social Impact. And again, always looking for collaborators, actively looking for somebody to hire in a part-time capacity as a researcher. But just to give you all a sense of where we are. So obviously, continuing to work really deeply on nonfiction storytelling for social change. We're looking at all the different areas that I mentioned with you all, marketplace distribution, storytelling effects, legal and journalistic protections to actually help documentary filmmakers work even more deeply in this space internationally and nationally. Diversity studies, there is a bit of advocacy to be done on that level, and so we need data to help push the industry to make some changes. So we've produced a couple of different studies that look at diversity in documentary, and that actually hasn't been touched before, so interesting. I didn't even get to talk about this, but I will tell you briefly that in the exploration into comedy and comedy effects and this model for Stand Up Planet, of course I was, and I worked for Norman Lear, who's like the greatest comedy social change guy of all time. So I wanted to expand this work to kind of translate and synthesize what we know about comedy and persuasive effects and persuasive appeals in different genres of comedy in an international context. So we have a project coming out that does that work. It's a kind of massive report that I hope at some point will become a book, but we'll see. I feel like once you read the report, you don't need the book. So what came out of that was a couple of studies, one in which we looked at Samantha Bee and a story about refugees compared to watching a traditional sort of CNN piece and looking at levels of empathy that were related to seeing the refugees actually speak on camera and be voiced versus looking at the sheer numbers of devastation. And so we are incubating comedy NGO partnerships with this work. So we're taking what comes from the social science literature and comes also from market research and from really amazing case studies around the world, and working with social issue NGOs and others to actually kind of train them. I sort of hesitate to use that word, but help them to understand how to use comedy. And so hopefully we'll incubate some real creative projects that come out of that, perhaps with Funny or Die and others, to actually do that work. And then in a cyclical way, we will continue to study it and find out what happens. We are a partner in a project with The Onion this summer. It's a comedy and social change summit that hasn't happened in this country. There was one in Israel, interestingly enough. But we'll bring together scholars and practitioners, but importantly, we'll bring comedy people into the room to actually start to talk about how we can intentionally build models around comedy and social justice work. The piece that I am hiring for on this research project, now I sound like a commercial, you can do all this at the Rise Up Media and Social Change Project. This is an entertainment education partnership with Univision. I mentioned this at the top of the talk, which works with owns Fusion, the English language channel. But this is a Rise Up is a cross-network, cross-platform social justice strand. And so specifically, that work is engaged with doing the kind of formative research and ultimately evaluation research, but importantly, taking that work and working with producers to actually influence how the stories are told around social justice issues. These are the ones that we're tackling just this year alone. It's quite a lot of work. Reproductive health, school readiness in vulnerable communities, early education gaps, and we have a big project on comedy and public health so in California, so we'll see how that goes. So this is a very pen-like project for someone, and a lot of great writing to be done, and hopefully more studies that come out of it. This is a project that Michael mentioned in my bio. I am just starting to work on this and trying to figure out what we want to do with it ultimately. But we really want to look at the role of narrative and story and symbol in contemporary social justice movements, because we're obviously in a resurgence of social movements, both in the United States and around the world. So we launched a convening last year where we brought together people who were working in this way, developed a kind of case study report to kind of map the space a little bit. So actually that report is coming out, I think in 2 weeks, as soon as I finish editing it. And what we hope to do is a lot of in-depth interviews with social movement leaders and creative producers working together. So we'll see. I can't say more on that because I'm not sure what we'll find. But that is storied movements. So I am at the end of my time. You thought it would never end. So I so hope that perhaps some of you might want to collaborate on this work. It's more than can be done by one person, but this is what motivates me all the time. And I thought there was no better place to bring it than to the Annenberg School. So thank you.
Let's
strategically left.
So we have time for a few questions, but Caty, what are you meeting? Is there a particular time you're meeting with students?
I think I'm 1:30.
Okay, so if students or anyone else hasn't already signed up to meet with Caty, you're welcome to.
Yeah.
If not, but you're interested in following up, there is, you can get a hold of her through the email address that's up there or talk to me. But I do think there are some research opportunities here that are worthwhile. But maybe one or two, if anyone has specific questions, either about the work itself or the center that she's running, we have time for a couple of questions.
There's no time for anything hard.
You had, I have one, and that's got to do with your experience being in both of these worlds of scholarship and practice.
Yeah.
And sometimes in my experience, when you do that, if you come from an academic world, you're sort of a weird combination of being kind of believed and thought of as irrelevant because the communication can be really bad. So and you've been doing this kind of work while working in the applied world, and now you're in an academic setting. Mm-hmm. What's that been like for you? How do those two things come together for you?
Well, I mean, there is some serious linguistic code switching, so I think that part is actually not even minor. So there are particular language and phrases that I won't use in my producer life, and the same applies to research work. But I feel like, honestly, for me, I'm just endlessly motivated by that space because I see how much there is a huge ecosystem around the world working intentionally between storytelling and social change. There's about to be a new foundation, which I'm not at liberty to tell you more about, but a $50 million project that looks at this kind of issue. The questions that are being asked in that community are not making it to the scholarly space. And the same is true in reverse. So for me, I am very happy to exploit that spot, because I equally appreciate and value both parts of it. So for me, frankly, when I get to bring in narrative transportation, the role of emotion, and the role of characters, and restoration of gravity, and all of that, it just makes me look smart. But it makes the work more effective. And I think for me, the motivation is, how can we make the work more effective? And as long as those ideas in the scholarly literature continue to be able to do that, I find no reason not to cross-pollinate. But I think there's a real hunger for scholars to be engaged in this part of the work. But I know it's tricky, right? Because also the sort of career path for scholarship has changed in the last 20 years. But I think you have to be pretty intentional about doing it in that way. But there's a lot of value. And you know, just as a fun fact, what I never say in my producer strategy life, like, for example, I'm going to this film festival that I mentioned after that, and we're doing this on-the-ground research and strategy session, I would never say in that setting, let me tell you about communication theory. Because that it's just a frame that, even though we know communication theory is the explanatory framework, right? We know it tells us why something happened, not just that it did. So I just, I'm just aware of where those moments are. Yeah, but that's an amazing space to be in, and I kind of hope there are more people that work in that space.
So are you meeting with students? Do you know, is it in this room that you're...
Do you guys know where we're meeting? Oh, okay.
Right in here? Okay, so if there are students who were not part of that but are interested in asking some questions or staying around, please feel free to do that. But why don't we use the time in between for individuals if they have any questions for you, they can go up and talk.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.